Welcome everyone to the Affordable Learning Georgia Featured Speaker Program. I'm Jeff Gallant, I'm the Program Director of Affordable Learning Georgia, and today we have Professor Kaylee Kendrick from Kennesaw State University. She's going to be talking about a curated resources collection for her Introduction to Computing Principles class. I can't wait to hear from her, and I'm going to turn it over to her right now. Please take it away.
All right, thanks so much, Jeff. If you don't mind going ahead and just advancing to the next slide for me, I'd really appreciate it. So hey everybody, I put my picture here so I didn't have to eat up our bandwidth with my video being on. I'm Professor Kaylee Kendrick. I am a lecturer of software engineering at Kennesaw State. I have been in this position, this is my fourth year, but I've been with the University System of Georgia and at Kennesaw State since 2010 in various capacities. When I was hired into this role in the College of Computing and Software Engineering, I was hired specifically to create a course called CSE 1300, which I'm going to talk about here. And in addition to my role on the first year experience team for the college teaching introductory computing courses, I am a student advocate, and by virtue of being a student advocate, I'm also a passionate open educational resource enthusiast. So that's just a little bit about me and what I do. For those of you who are unfamiliar with KSU, we are an R2 institution located in Metro Atlanta, and our first year experiences team serves over 1,000 students a semester, and a growing portion of that is 1,300. So what is 1300? So for those of you with computing backgrounds, you know that CS0, CS1, and CS2 are offerings that are offered in institutions throughout the United States. KSU did not have a CS0 class, which is, CS0 is sort of like interchangeable with AP Computing Principles. It's a very introductory computing class that introduces both programming and also the basics of computing, not how to use Microsoft Word per se, but how computers work, how they think, and all of the information that you need in order to successfully program them. So when I was hired, I was asked to create this course and offer it simultaneously. Learned a whole bunch through that process. And mostly what I learned is what the college's vision was for this course, which was that they wanted to provide opportunities for students who had no background or very limited confidence in their capabilities to sort of test the waters in a computing class where there was no gate for grades to the next class, where it was an elective credit that they could use and then take with them if they decided not to continue into computing, or they could count as a free elective for a computing major. And the consensus that I got in speaking with the college's leadership, everybody had some idea of what they wanted in CSE 1300, and that varied a great deal. But mostly what they said is they really wanted it to serve as kind of a very gentle introduction to computing and programming, because what they had seen was that students that started in the major programming courses, our CS1 and CS2 offerings, a lot of them ended up not doing very well, and there was really no step back for them to start and build confidence before they went into this class that required a B from them in order to continue forward. Jeff, do you mind advancing the slide for me, please? Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the problem, and if you'll advance one more for me, please. So there were some problems in the beginning, as there always are. There was this situation that kind of got me looking at what could I do to make this a better course. And the first thing was that when I was hired, they had already selected a textbook for the course, and it wasn't a real textbook, it was a subscription. And originally it was in the $78 range. We navigated and negotiated down to the $54 per subscription range. And there were problems with this resource. It was extremely limited in content. And what I mean by that is each chapter was maybe 2.5 pages max. And the content was not, it was meant to be a place for faculty members to go in and sort of share their expertise by building out the resource for this company we were paying. And I was really uncomfortable with this idea of creating content for a company to use, because once I built the content and put it into their platform, how was it being used? Who was getting credit for it? You know, who was responsible for its upkeep? So I had some concerns about the content creation aspect of using this source. The other thing we were facing was that there were really some major accessibility concerns. The resource was not something we had curated or created. It was web hosted. So the students would log in with this code and they would go to this website, and we had no control over things like contrast, text to speech. You know, if the images had appropriate alt text, all of these things that we're concerned about as educators to make sure that we're providing equitable access for our students. So that was a major concern for me, and I was constantly having to reach out to the publisher every time I got an accommodations request for the class to make sure that it was compliant, and if it wasn't, trying to come up with an alternative, which was concerning. And I sort of played this role of facilitating discussions between the publisher, the bookstore, and my department, and it was exhausting. So I would talk to the publisher and I would ask them to keep the code the same. Invariably, every semester they would create a new code, which would then have to be communicated to the bookstore. And sometimes by the time we got that information to the bookstore, they had already sold the old code. So then it was me interfacing between the students and the publisher, trying to get the old code swapped out for the new code. And as you can imagine, it took a lot of time. The other thing that really concerned me that I didn't like was there were situations in which students had delayed access or no access at all to course materials. So I would have students who got a month or two into the class who still had not purchased the subscription. I had students who chose not to purchase the subscription at all because the subscription expired at the end of the semester. So they were just paying for a code for a resource they weren't even going to be able to continue with. And then probably most concerning of all, aside from just pedagogical differences, I really didn't agree with charging students money for this resource. The content reviews from the student were just really lackluster. There were some things they enjoyed about the resource, but overall, nobody was really impressed with it, myself included. And so it was really hard to build a course around a resource I wasn't inspired by or excited about. Jeff, if you could advance again, please. And so what I ended up with was this product that came out of the grant. So I want to talk first about the product, and then I'm going to talk about how I got to the product, challenges along the way, and sort of where we stand now. Slide, please. So this is my resource that I built using the ALG grant. It's hosted in OpenALG. You can click on the original publication button if we were on the website at the moment. It's this is just a screenshot, but Jeff, thank you, has posted this in the chat. So if you were to click on the original publication button, it would take you to my faculty webpage where I have all of these in an accordion structure. But if you were to click start reading, if you'll advance the slide, please. Thank you. What you would see is this table of contents. And the table of contents is divided modularly, and these modules match the weeks on my syllabus. So if you were to go to my syllabus right now, we're on week 2 of abstraction and logic gates. And so these resources match in title and content what is on the student syllabus, the material that's inside of our learning system. Everything matches. There's no confusion over what goes with what. And then you can see here that instead of choosing a single textbook, because this is a survey level class that covers a lot of material for different ideas and different fields in computing, what I've done instead is I've curated resources. In some weeks there are textbook chapters, in other weeks it's literally all articles or even some original sources. Like you'll notice this module is covering abstraction and logic gates, and in this module we talk about a concept called Moore's Law, which is the idea that computers will get less expensive over time because we can fit more transistors onto dense integrated circuits. And rather than just telling them this, what I'm able to do is actually to assign inside of my curated resources this original article from Electronics Magazine back in the 60s for the students to read. And then I'm also able to provide them with a more current article that discusses why this is significant. One of the things that I learned in talking with students about what they wanted from this class is that students don't like to read anymore, which for me, as somebody who came originally from a background in English Lit, was kind of, it was a different way of thinking about how we could share content with students, because I loved reading and I did a lot of it in school. But students are really interested in multimedia content now. And I think most surprisingly, what I found out in talking about things with students is they access a lot of this content from their phone, even if they do have a laptop or a tablet. So one of the things that was cool about selecting these resources is I was able to select them in such a way where students were able to utilize them on their phones, which means that they can access this content from anywhere. The multimedia content that I looked for, as I said, I had concerns about accessibility, so I was able to go out, find resources, make sure they came from reputable sources, and then to double check things like captioning and if they came with a transcript. And they're all listed all together under the module. Slide, please. In addition to reading and viewing material that serves as the content for the course, I was able to curate some study resources by topic. This is an example of one of the games that I was able to include that I found doing research for this project. It is a video game that allows you to practice converting numbers from binary to decimal and from decimal to binary. And you can see I've got some other things there, practice worksheets, logic gate sorting games, even an odometer that shows how counting in binary looks. And these are all just in that little table of contents and separated by category so that the students have them. Slide, please. So now that you've seen sort of what the final experience for the students looks like, I want to talk you through the process of how I got to that point. Slide, please. Okay. So as a computer scientist, when I started on this project, of course, I wanted an algorithm. I wanted to plan out how this was going to work, what it would look like. And so I did this first in 2019. I developed a plan for what I thought this course should look like and what sort of resources I should have. And what I did was I went to my department chair and I went to my dean and my associate dean and I said, hey, I have this plan for this course. I think I found a way to get it funded. I'd love to get your support. And our college has a longstanding history with Affordable Learning Georgia. We have lots of classes that have gone through this grant process where faculty have collaborated together to create these resources for our students and save them money. And so getting the support was easy. People were more than willing to write letters. They were willing to share their experiences working on their own grants. And so I submitted a proposal. And that was in 2019. And my first proposal did not go through. So I had to step back and evaluate my proposal and garner more support and make a stronger plan and then resubmit it in 2020 for round 17. And I did, and I secured the grant. And then once the grant was secure, I had to do all of the things. And by all of the things, I mean I had to go back through the course to see what students liked about it to begin with. I had to decide what my topics were going to be, because when you have a course that's built around a textbook, your topics tend to line up with that textbook if you've found a decent one, or you have to try and make your content line up with the text resource. But in this case, there was really no limit to what topics I could choose other than what the course learning outcomes were. So that's sort of where I started. I reviewed the course learning outcomes. I reviewed how many weeks were in a semester. I looked to see how we could chunk material so it would work well for both an 8-week and a 16-week offering. And then once I had the topics, that's when I went and started compiling resources. And I think we all sort of do this anyway as faculty members. I don't know if anybody else has a folder on their desktop that's literally just where they drag and drop things they come across when they are looking at their course for the semester to look at and evaluate later to see if it might be helpful. But this is something I do. I have a folder on my desktop. So I started with that folder, looked to see if I had anything good. I found one or two things that I really liked that I chose as sort of the primary resources for the major languages that we cover in this class. We cover Java and we cover HTML and CSS. So once I found major resources to support those two modules, I was then able to go and do a very specific library search for each of the other modules to try and find text resources. And then once I found good text resources that I was comfortable with, most of which came out of the library, I was able to go out and really look for multimedia resources that complemented the material well or showcased it in a way that I thought would be compelling for students. And I got a lot of this material, the multimedia material, either came from TED Talks, TED Ed, which is a terrific website. If you're not familiar with them, I really recommend it. I also did a lot of looking on sites like NPR for interviews with the historical figures that were involved in some of these projects. And then some original resources, right? Like, why tell these folks about George Boole or Gordon Moore when I could actually go and pull those folks, their writing, and share that original resource with the students so they can see how we got to where we are from where it started. Once I had gathered the resources and I had checked to make sure they were accessible, the way that I started this was I started by piloting them as optional supplemental resources. So I would roll out a couple of these a semester see what the students thought, request feedback from the students. And I did this sort of informally and then also by reviewing the end of term feedback. So informally at the end of the semester, I would spend half a class period and I would open up the floor and say, hey, I want to talk through the content for this course. Can you tell me what was helpful for you and what wasn't? And then using that feedback, I would go back and I would reduce resources, replace ones that weren't really very good, flesh out extra material for the modules that were not, well supported enough by the material. And then I would just submit the semester report and then start the process over again for the next term until finally in fall of 2021, I had the course ready to go. The grant had finalized and it was ready to go and to be utilized. We had piloted it in its complete form in that summer, the last semester of the grant, and we let it roll and saw how it went. Next slide, please. All right. I think whenever faculty members look at taking on extra responsibilities, one of the things they want to know is what could stall this process, right? How could I get hung up along the way? Slide, please. So these were the parts that for me were difficult. So when I applied for the grant the second time, I had a co-PI. And the co-PI, a couple weeks into the project, had to step out of the project for other responsibilities. And so I found myself working on this project that had been approved after my second round of applying for the grant by myself. And so one of the things I would say is if I had to go through this process again, I would have preferred to work with more than just one other person because I had to absorb this other faculty member's work along with my own plans for the grant. And so that was really, it was more of a time commitment than I had expected. The other challenge, of course, was trying to reapply when I really thought my proposal was strong to begin with. And I sort of had to reframe it in my head as, wow, there must be so many amazing proposals that mine didn't make it through. How can I make mine stand out next time? So one of the things that I did after I didn't make it through with my first round of proposals is I went out and I read the proposals that had made it through. And I looked at their proposals on the ALG website and tried to find aspects of their proposal that I thought were particularly strong and that would translate well to my own project. I got inspired, in other words, by my colleagues and used that to rewrite the proposal. The other thing that was surprisingly daunting was when you have a course that's built around a textbook, you have some limitations for those resources because you're limited to what's in the textbook and what you can make work with the textbook. When you start from scratch and you say, hey, I'm going to design this course around brand new resources, it can be a little overwhelming to try and cull down to what's really important. And for me, that was really challenging because it's a survey course. I want them to know everything they need to know, and trying to determine what parts of that are really necessary for the students was a challenge. And so some of the things I did was I talked to colleagues that taught classes above this one to see where they thought the students needed the most help. And that's actually how I came up with what programming constructs I was going to focus on for the Java lessons. I talked to the folks who taught CS1 and CS2 and data structures, and I said, hey, could you tell me where your students are getting hung up? Where are they really struggling? And once we identified those areas where we were really struggling, we built the modules to give that content the most time in this class. And then the other thing too was kind of thoughtfully evaluating our learning objectives. So the learning objectives for this class are very vague and very broad. There are only four of them, and they are things like demonstrate algorithmic thinking. And so in one way, that's really empowering because there's a zillion ways you can demonstrate algorithmic thinking. Measuring it's a different thing altogether. And so I would say that for me, if I had to go back through it, I might have had more specific conversations with leadership about why the learning objectives for this class had been chosen and if it made sense to continue with those same objectives. I know one of our plans going forward is to reevaluate the objectives for this class and see if they still make sense. And then it's not on the slide, but one of the other things that I really struggled with was how to distribute my time over the project. So I actually started with the second half of the course and built those resources first. The second half of this course is taught in Java. And so I started with the Java content because I had a textbook for that. And so it was easy to build multiple modules from that single resource. And to be honest, it took more time to accumulate those other resources, which is why I saved them for later in the process of the grant to kind of evaluate what to include. So those were the biggest challenges. And then I guess if I had to pick one thing that I think was the most challenging of all, when you get a textbook from a publisher, usually there's some sort of supplements accompaniment, right? Like a test bank or quiz bank. And there was none of that for this. So trying to decide what to use for test questions, quiz questions, assignments, having to start from scratch with all of that was, it was a challenge. And if I had to go back and do it all over again, what I would have done is I would have started with the rubrics first and then built the assignment from the rubric instead of creating assignments and then trying to create a rubric from them. I think reverse engineering that might have been better. Slide. Okay. So now that we've rolled this out and it's been going on for a couple of semesters, I want to talk about what it looks like and how it's been received by the students and my colleagues. Slide, please. All right. So between when I was hired in fall of 2018 and fall 2021, if you compare semester enrollment, so in this case, I'm comparing fall against fall because we have some enrollment trends at our university where in the fall we have really high enrollment in our freshman level classes and then in spring it dips down, which makes sense if you think about when freshmen tend to join. So this class has seen 60% enrollment increase since the semester I was hired. Because of this enrollment increase, we've been able to add additional sections. We've also been able to offer the course on multiple campuses. And we've also rolled out an online version of this course. So we're offering about 3 sections in the fall and then 2 in the spring and 1 to 2 in the summer, depending on enrollment. We've served over 1,000 students since we started piloting the materials in fall of 2020, which is the first semester we stopped charging students for resources. And that represents $62,000 in student savings by eliminating those textbook subscription fees. And that's just so far. You're talking about an academic year and a semester. So we're really excited about how much money we're going to save students. The other thing I'm really excited about with that is I have not once had to have a conversation with a student since I rolled out this grant material about how they were going to afford a textbook or how they couldn't afford a textbook or how even if they could afford the subscription fee, they didn't have a computer at home that they could use with this tool. So it's eliminated a lot of really uncomfortable conversations. I haven't had to go out and buy resources for students, which is something I had done in previous jobs when students came to me with financial trouble. The other thing about it is when students reach out to me before the semester starts and say, hey, how can I prepare for your class? I'm able to go ahead and give them the link to the ALG content and let them get started at no cost. So students can even sort of try out the class before they're enrolled to see if it's something they're really interested in. Slide. Thank you. Our end of term evaluations from the students have been really pretty consistently good, definitely above the departmental norm. So here are a couple of quotes that I pulled out from my students. They like how the course is set up and they mentioned the accessibility. The information taught is essential and taught in a way that they feel prepared for the next programming class. They feel they learned a lot about the course topics and discovered valuable resources to further their knowledge. A lot of students actually will come back to me after the course is over and tell me how they've utilized the resources I provided in upper level classes. I think most memorably, I had a student, we'll call him Nick, and he came back to me this year and he actually sent me pictures of him using some of the free resources that I built to accompany this material, some lecture guides in his upper level classes. So it's a picture of his lap and he's got a folder labeled 1300 and it's got all of this content where he had taken notes in my class that he's now using for his upper level computer architecture classes. And so it's really kind of cool to see this elective credit that students took being used to help them finish their degree programs. And then finally, this one was really satisfying. I have a lot of students who take this class despite having AP credit already for a similar class. And so this quote really made me feel pretty good. I've taken previous computer science classes, but this one went more in depth with coding in different languages alongside of what makes computer science possible, like how technology has advanced in the past 50 years so we can be where we are today. And what's so tremendously gratifying about that to me is because I came from a humanities and social sciences background and integrated into STEM, I absolutely love when my students can draw the two fields together, when they can look at something and say, hey, not only is this technology important, but here's how it's impacted our society, or here's how these people from other fields made a difference in computing, or how computing made a difference for people in these other fields. So I love that students can come to me with programming experience and still get something very valuable out of the class. Slide. The other thing that's been great about this is in my team at KSU, we actually team teach all our courses in first year experience. So what that means is each course, has a coordinator, and each coordinator is responsible for the content of their course, and it's offered in the same manner across all sections. So if I'm teaching a section and my colleague is teaching a section, we have the same assessments, the same assignments, and the students have access to the same material, although the instructors have flexibility to add extra examples and to kind of tailor it. So this is instructor feedback from an instructor that's been with me since the first semester, who went through the let's build as we go phase of things. And he said that teaching 1300 using the ALG materials is great. It allows us the flexibility to incorporate newer articles, activities, and materials into the course without having to wait for them to be added into a pre-made textbook. In addition, it allows us to use it allows the use of the resources for a particular topic and gives us the freedom to choose from all available materials for a topic and to change examples and references at a moment's notice. And I kind of mirror this. One of the most gratifying things about this was when COVID started, we had a lot of students who were struggling emotionally with everything that was going on with the pandemic. And so one of the ways that we adjusted to try and give students room to sort of explore their feelings was we made one of our assignments about COVID. We assigned articles and materials about how computing was being used through the pandemic to do things like model how the virus was spreading and to talk about how vaccine distribution could be tracked using computers. And we were able to do that really easily because we didn't have to build around a textbook. We could just implement a new module seamlessly by adding it in. And at the end of the semester, when it was no longer relevant, we could take it out. And I actually have some of those materials to hand off to Tiffany and Jeff to include in the resources if somebody else wanted to do an assignment that was tailored specifically to current events, which is something I think the students really get a lot out of. Slide, please. Okay, so what's next for 1300? It's anybody's best guess where we're headed, particularly since the pandemic has changed things so dramatically. But my plans for 1300 are to continue to utilize open resources to build new modules as faculty identify areas where students need room to improve on their skills. I'm not sure how the rest of you feel about your students' math or reading and writing skills, but I find that a lot of times some of the most rudimentary skills are the areas where the students struggle. And so we're able to add content. For example, we spend over a week on PEMDAS to talk about how mathematics works on paper before I start letting them loose with a computer to do the math. So we continue to identify areas where students need strength and we can change them out and supplement them with these resources. The other thing is that I am sort of an OER evangelist now. I talk to my colleagues about other classes where I see room where they could save their students money, or where we're already utilizing free resources that could use a refresh, because ALG actually offers another grant where you can refresh an offering after a period of time has gone by if you need new content. So constantly looking for opportunities to save our students money, to make our courses more impactful and meaningful, and to allow us the opportunity to share all the work that we've done with the community, because what's the point in this, you know, assembling all these resources if we don't provide them to our colleagues? And save them from having to reinvent the wheel. So that is it. I'm about 30 minutes in, a little faster than I meant to go. I apologize. But I thought I would open up the floor for questions and see what everybody has to say.
Well, first, I just wanted to say thank you for the presentation. I think you got everything across in 30 minutes. I don't think it was too fast. I think the information was really, really good.
Thank you.
So please enter your questions into the chat. I am unable to change the options to unmute people and stuff like that due to some weird permissions things in Microsoft Teams today. It's a weird time. I'll start things off with a question. So the grants that we've seen that have gotten majorly disrupted or where OER suddenly was discontinued, that they usually have to do with some sort of turnover within the department, especially with a lead or a project manager. And in 2022, we are definitely in an era of massive amounts of turnover. So if you were going to create a proposal now that that accounts for this and that protects against the disruption that would happen if someone were to suddenly leave the project, what would you do? What would you include in that proposal?
If I were to reapply, knowing what I know now about what it's like to lose a team member in the process, the first thing is I wouldn't go into this as just a pair. I would probably try and gather three or four faculty members for two reasons, right? One, if somebody has to step out, you can more evenly distribute the load. But also, because you, especially for a survey course, you're welcoming expertise in various areas. So I'll give a for instance, my background before I joined College of Computing and Software Engineering was that I taught web application development at the technical college, real small classes, computers in front of the students, and this is an unplugged computer science class. I have up to 200 students in a lecture hall with no access to a computer unless they bring one. So it's a very different format. My colleague, Doug, who's been teaching this course with me since we both joined in fall of 2018, his background is a lot of hardware support and actual hands-on dealing with clients and dealing with the computers themselves, not so much the programming of them. I would have loved to have included him in the grant originally so that he could have brought that expertise in and built some modules around hardware. As it was, I ended up going to him with a lot of questions for that module, but I would have loved to loop him in to add that varied perspective. And then also I would have had a frank conversation with college leadership for a contingency plan, because one of the things that was offered to me when I did lose my partner in this was that I could identify another faculty member to take over that part of the grant. And unfortunately, there just wasn't anybody that had the time to commit to it. So I think I would have deepened my bench. I would have had somebody who was already on hand who we knew we could turn to if there was turnover for some reason. And I would have probably included that information in the grant.
Okay, so Lucy is talking about some of the copyrighted content links. You have a DOI, which is a digital object identifier for some folks out there who are reading this and going, what is a DOI? This kind of permanently links to a particular resource, but it doesn't assume that you're at KSU. The student needs to pick an institution. Others, you're using a KSU specific link. Non-KSU instructors would figure it out if they want to adopt the materials, but it is an extra step for them to figure out the link for their institution. Yeah, this is a tough one that has to do with sometimes finding permalinks and sometimes specifying which things are maybe library resources and which aren't. Some of these are library resources, correct?
Yeah, all of the non-textbook resources are links to articles that I got through the library system. And Tiffany's actually the one who suggested using the DOIs. And I think that the links are actually different. So in the citations that have the DOI, the top link is actually different from the DOI link. So they hyperlink to two different things, one to the DOI and one to the library itself. My understanding, though, is that if a student is part of a USG institution, they can still get these resources from the library, which is why I included the entire link. So that if instructors wanted to adopt the resources, they could use the link to secure the material from their own library. If there's a better way to do that, I'm totally, totally open to that.
Yes, this is uniform, right? You've got in the title you link the KSU one, mm-hmm. Which includes an EDS link. Mm-hmm. And then in the other one, you've got the DOI link is what points to kind of open web page for the thing, even if you're paywalled.
Yes.
Yeah, let me just apologize. That was totally just me reading it wrong. I thought they were reading that as two separate items. But no, you did exactly what you should have done and ignore my quibbling point. Sorry.
No, I appreciate it, because if there's a way to make it better, I'd like to. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's a tough one. I think if you want to include like a bit of instructions for folks who aren't at KSU and in how to adapt this, and put it in a little section, you know, like the back matter of what is essentially kind of a curated textbook, that can help out folks as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And maybe one of the things we might want to do is to just create a list of citations that faculty members could take to their respective institutions to secure links. Because before I did this on the ALG website, I actually had built into our learning management system a library reading list. And that's how the students got to these. So they didn't actually have to go to the library's website at all. They would just go into our LMS and click through the reading list. And so I have those citations. And maybe what we just need to do is throw a disclaimer that says, hey, if you need a list of these citations to provide your institution, you know, please contact. And then I have my email. Just a thought.
Yeah, I mean, using library resources is something that we definitely recommend. And there are these types of link issues as soon as you go outside of the institution. So it's not uncommon to have this kind of problem, for sure. I think anything that can help them out really helps. Oh, Dr. Gozer says, how much support did you have from upper administration about using OER?
How upper? How far up would you like me to go? Like dean's office, or are we going like all the way up to the provost?
Yeah, so she says dean.
Dean. Sure. So we've had a lot of turnover at KSU in our college. So we've had our dean leave, we've had chairs leave. We're just going through a leadership transition. People are retiring. But from the very beginning, because my college has such a strong relationship with Affordable Learning Georgia, at this point, I think, and Jeff, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure we have entire degrees now that are basically free content.
Through the IT department. The BSIT and MSIT projects are Z degrees now because of all of the successful projects that they've taken on through textbook transformation grants and their sustainability plans in the background.
Yeah, so there was a lot of support built in simply by virtue of the leadership team having seen this done and done well. And then also, because of the way we teach this class, where we teach it across the whole department and we deliver the same content, I was able to show a lot of value just by volume, right? So like, if we're going to touch 500 students, let's say we're up to 400 a semester at this point. If I'm going to touch, let's say 700 for the year, you know, that's a substantial amount of savings for the students. I had a lot of support just because they'd seen it done before, but I came to them with information. I came to them with student evaluations and said, hey, the content we're building this course around really is not what it could be. I have this plan. I think that we could do this better. And they were very supportive, especially my associate dean, who had worked on some of these projects herself in the past. And so I didn't have any trouble securing letters from them or support. I did take this as a stipend instead of a course release. I think you have the option to do either. It would have been a heavy ask for me to ask the department to release me from a course because of my the way my workload is determined. I'm 100% teaching, and I teach somewhere between 300 and 400 students a semester myself and do grading across the division, so over 1,000. So by making sure that the department had the resources they needed and I still got compensated, we were able to really quickly determine that this would be a great value add and it really wouldn't impact the way that the department worked, which was great. And then also, they're really supportive of faculty members wanting to do things to make the content more appealing, especially in our survey courses. So this was really looked at as a way to bring students in who didn't have that background, who might end up choosing our college. And the results have actually been kind of surprising. We now have programs across the college, specifically our psychology department, that's listing this now as an elective in their actual major plan. So we had a lot of students, from the psychology department taking this class, and some of them continue on to get minors or even to switch their majors. So the support was there from the beginning, which I really appreciated. And then also, I came into the college with a fair amount of experience in developing courses because of my work with Dr. Tamara Powell, who's from the College of Humanities and Social Sciences at Kennesaw State, and she does build a course workshops to teach faculty about accessibility and building online content. And so that was an area that they had hired me specifically with that in mind, me being able to create these online courses for them. So by telling them about the accessibility issues I was experiencing using this platform, I was able to garner really quick support for choosing resources that were going to allow us to meet those accessibility standards without having to exhaustively double check the publisher's content or request different material to provide the students who had accommodation plans. We have a lot of students that come to us with hearing impairments and visual impairments, as well as other conditions that make it really difficult for them to connect with material that isn't set up to be accessible. So by capitalizing on that idea, this idea that we could just make the course accessible from the get-go, that was really embraced by college leadership as something we should be doing just because it was the right thing to do for our students. So the support was always there, which I appreciated.
Oh, Dr. Gomez says that is wonderful.
Yeah, we're very, very lucky in that regard. As long as we can tie what we're trying to do to our students having a better experience, I found that our leadership, even through the leadership changes, has been really open to that. It's our motivating factor. How does this affect our students? How can we do our jobs better?
Okay, I want to give just a little bit of extra time to make sure if anyone has any questions, they can type them right into chat. Okay, that is my teacherly amount of awkward silence. Oh, wait, I see that Lucy is typing. Oh, Lucy says this was great and thanks.
Thank you for coming.
We hear you, Lucy. Your mic is on.
Oh, okay, sorry. I don't know what happened there. I didn't.
Oh.
I said what I needed to say in the chat. Sorry.
Oh, and a great presentation. And thank you from Dr. Herman Vargas, another famed OER advocate, along with Thomas Gonzalez, too. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. Thank you for Dr. Kendrick for presenting all of this cool information, for talking about a really helpful resource. It's pretty unique in the world of ALG, and I really hope that library resources adoptions get more and more common, and we can share more and more information on how to make them usable as possible as we go down the line. So thank you so much, Dr. Kendrick, for presenting, and thank you all for being here today. I'm going to stop the recording now and wish you all a wonderful weekend.
Thanks, you as well. Take care, everybody.
Take care.